This video is part one in a series about the Super Nintendo's sound system, commonly known as the SPC700. This series of videos is a direct sequel to the series about the Super NES's main features. Its sound subsystem is so complex and separated from the rest of the architecture that it deserves its own video series. You might want to watch the video in the SNES features series about the SPC700, since it talks more about the SNES's side of things. In this video, I'll just be introducing the audio system and listing out everything it includes and is capable of. After that, we'll be ready to take a deeper dive later on with more in-depth videos. Recall this diagram from the video I mentioned earlier in the last series. Let's fill this in with a lot more detail. We'll look at the main processor behind all of the audio work, the SSMP. The SMP, or Sound and Music Processor, is commonly referred to as the SPC700. Or perhaps even the entire audio subsystem is commonly referred to as the SPC700. But technically speaking, the SMP implements the SPC700 instruction set. To do so, it includes a handful of different registers, including the accumulator A, index registers X and Y, stack pointer SP, program counter PC, and the program status word PSW. Each of these registers are 8 bits wide and are used to execute code. Sometimes the Y and A registers are bundled together to make a single register YA, which is used for a few 16-bit instructions. The CPU also reserves 16 bytes in memory as other various registers and input-output ports. These can be accessed via memory locations hex 00F0 through 00FF. The first byte at address hex 00F0 is a testing register that modifies the behavior of the processor itself. Most of these are detrimental and cause the CPU to crash, which is why this register is usually plastered with a big Do Not Touch sign. The upper two bits control adding extra cycles to instructions that access I/O ports and the boot ROM. The next two bits control adding extra cycles to instructions that access audio RAM. The lower four bits enable and disable reading and writing to RAM, as well as interacting with the timers, which I'll get to in a moment. Address hex 00F1 is defined as a proper control register. The highest bit toggles the visibility of the 64-byte boot ROM. When this bit is set, the region of audio RAM from hex FFC0 to FFFF will return the boot ROM when read. When it is reset, the actual values in RAM can be read instead. Writing, however, will always go through to RAM no matter what this bit is set to. Bit 4 will clear SNES input ports hex 2140 and 2141, and bit 5 will clear ports hex 2142 and 2143 when they are set. This is not the same as writing 0 to addresses hex 00F4 through 00F7, as that would clear the output ports. These two bits will actually clear the input ports. The bottom three bits are used to properly enable and disable the timers. Registers hex 00F2 and 00F3 are the input-output ports used to communicate with the DSP. I'll talk about those later. And registers hex 00F4 through 00F7 are the input-output ports used to communicate with the SNES. I won't go into too much detail here, since the last video I talked about earlier does that plenty enough. Registers hex 00F8 and 00F9 are auxiliary port registers. The SMP chip has 16 pins that correspond to the 8 bits in each of these registers, but they're not connected to anything. Therefore, they just act like general purpose registers and can be used for any purpose. The final 6 registers, hex 00FA through 00FF, are used by the timers. Here's an overview on how the timers work. The timers are important for keeping a steady heartbeat for any program running on the SMP. Unlike the SNES CPU, which has the NMI and blanking interval to synchronize with, The audio subsystem must keep a steady beat on its own, and it does so using these timers. Everything starts from a 2.048 MHz clock signal that is sent from the DSP chip to the SMP chip. This clock signal is divided by 32 and 256 to create a 64 kHz clock and an 8 kHz clock respectively. These clocks feed into a few hidden counter registers that simply count up by one each clock pulse. These counters are compared to the first set of registers, hex 00FA through 00FC. They essentially represent the maximum value of the hidden counter. When the counter reaches the value in this register, the counter resets to zero. This means that a larger value will make the counter reset less often, and a smaller value will make it reset more quickly. Additionally, whenever the counter is reset back to zero, another counter register is incremented. These are the last three registers readable through addresses hex 00FD through 00FF. Only the lower four bits are used, so these counters can go from 0 to 15 before rolling back over to 0. Also, whenever these counters are read by the CPU, they are automatically reset to 0, without affecting any of the other timer circuitry. These timers have quite a large range of resolutions and can be used for many different purposes. At the slowest setting, the 8 kHz clock at a maximum internal counter value of 256 causes the output counter to roll over only every 512 milliseconds, which is just over half a second, or about 31 SNES frames. At the fastest setting, the 64 kHz clock at a minimum internal counter value of 1 causes the output counter to roll over every 250 microseconds, or about 1.5% of a single SNES frame. The digital signal processor, or DSP, is where the audio signal is actually created. It has over 100 different registers to control how and when sounds are played. There are 8 voices that can each play sounds independently, and the DSP mixes them all together into a stereo digital audio signal. In addition to being able to play BRR formatted samples at various volumes and pitches with customizable gain and ADSR envelopes, it has a built-in echo functionality complete with an FIR filter application. Another uncommonly used feature is the ability to modulate the pitch of a voice via an adjacent voice. That is, instead of the waveform created by a voice being mixed into the final audio stream, it is used as a parameter to shift the pitch of another voice up or down. The DSP also has a very bare-bones noise generator with a few parameters. All of these registers are located in the DSP itself and are not memory mapped. The only way to access them is through registers hex 00F2 and 00F3, as mentioned earlier. First, the 8-bit DSP register number is written to address hex 00F2. Then, that register can be written to by writing a value to address hex 00F3. It can also be read by reading address 00F3. This means that all modifications to all DSP registers are done through this pair of memory addresses. The output of the DSP is a digital audio signal. Every sample of the stereo output is 16 bits. All of the data sent from the DSP to the digital-to-analog converter is serialized and sent via a single data line. The DAC holds each sample's data in a buffer and then produces 2 analog signals, one for each channel. After some amplification and mixing with the audio pins from the expansion port and the cartridge port, these signals end up at the red and white cables that plug into your television. The final component of the audio system is the 64 kilobytes of general purpose audio RAM, or ARAM. It is accessed by the SMP as well as the DSP for several different purposes. There are many different things that all need to be stored in ARAM, so it needs to be carefully organized so that nothing conflicts with one another. The actual sound engine program that the SMP executes in order to process music and sound effects and tell the DSP what to do fits into ARAM. All in any variables, data, and tables the program needs are stored here as well. This includes all of the music data and sound effect data. The first 256 bytes of ARAM is called the zero page and is where more commonly used variables are stored, since there are instructions that can be optimized for use with the zero page. The next 256 bytes are dedicated for the program stack, as the highest 8 bits of the stack pointer are hard-coded to be 1. The DSP also reads sample data from ARAM, as well as the directory table that denotes where the starting and looping points for all of the samples are located. And finally, the echo buffer is held in ARAM too. It's not uncommon for all of the music, sound effects, and sample data in a game to not entirely fit into ARAM at the same time. This is perfectly fine because the only data that needs to be in ARAM is all of the data for the currently playing soundtrack. When it comes time to play a different track that isn't in ARAM, the audio can be paused while the SNES uploads new data to the APU. In fact, some music tracks are so big or so complex that tracks can be streamed to the audio system. That is, music and sample data can be transferred from the SNES side to the APU side while the SMP is still busy ordering the DSP around. These kinds of songs are infamous for not being able to be saved as an SPC file to be played on a desktop computer. That's because an SPC file is just a big snapshot of ARAM and the DSP and SMP registers. A program that plays an SPC file is just an SPC700 emulator that takes the digital output from the emulated DSP and converts it into PCM samples to be played on a newer machine. Thank you for watching, and I hope this video series is able to shed more light onto the already well-renowned SPC700 audio subsystem. The next video will dive into the SPC700 instruction set and compare its differences from the Super NES's main instruction set, 65C816. A special shout-out is deserved for all of the people who are listed on the screen right now. By supporting Retro Game Mechanics Explained on Patreon or Subscribestar, you can have your name listed here too. You'll get early access to every video before it is released publicly, and be able to view creator commentary live streams afterwards. I would definitely not be able to do all the work I do here if it weren't for everyone's generous support, so thank you.